The United States is a nation of immigrants, yet today, few topics are more controversial than that of immigration. And that's exactly what we're talking about next on Significant Insights. With a growing crisis on the southern border today, immigration is in the forefront of both the news as well as politics. My guest, Matt Soerens, works with refugees and immigrants through the Ministry of Rural Relief. With co-author Jenny Yang, he has written the book, Welcoming the Stranger, which brings to light the complex issues surrounding immigration. Matt, good to have you with me on the program.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming. I've been wanting to talk about this issue, but when you talk about, when you say the word immigration today, red flags go up all over the place from both sides of the issue, and there's a lot of polarization about the issue. Explains, you're involved in it with Rural Relief. This is pretty much what you do. Explain some of the complexities that you see in the immigration issue today.
Sure. I think for a lot of Americans and for a lot of Christians in particular, this is an issue that raises a lot of conflicting feelings. Because on one hand, we want to love and welcome people. That's a biblical idea. There's a lot of scriptural reasons for that. We also want to uphold the law. That's also a biblical idea. So a lot of Americans feel some tension here between, well, can we do all that at the same time? Can we be kind and compassionate and welcome the stranger and at the same time honor the law in a context where not all, in fact, not even the majority, but a significant minority of immigrants in the country are not here lawfully. They've either crossed the border illegally or have overstayed what was supposed to be a temporary
visa. And I think you've just probably defined what the majority of at least middle America would describe as what they believe is the answer. We believe in immigration. We want, you know, we're a nation of immigrants, as opposed to, say, a country like Japan or someplace mm-hmm. like that, which is not. I mean, they're pretty homogenous, but we're not. I mean, you know, we have people who have come here from all over the world. So, yeah, we like immigration. We also like law and order. So figure out a way you can do both of those.
Yeah, you know, what we've said at World Relief for more than a decade now is that in terms of the policy question, because the fundamental question for us is how do we treat the neighbors who are in front of us who happen to be immigrants. But in terms of the policy question, we've said for a long time it ought to be harder to immigrate illegally to this country. We should have secure borders. We should check people coming in on a temporary visa to make sure they go back. But concurrently, it should be easier to immigrate legally. We think that we need a legal immigration system, not unlimited, but that meets the needs of our U.S. labor markets, that allows families to be reunited in a reasonable basis, and that continues to allow the United States to be a place of refuge for some of the most vulnerable people around the world who have fled persecution, whether because of their Christian faith or a political opinion or whatever reason. And we think if we bring those two pieces together, making it harder to immigrate illegally and easier to immigrate legally, we think that's actually the sweet spot for what our immigration system should look like.
And there was a time when it was a lot easier to come into the United States, but at the same time you did come through Ellis Island and you were processed and people came here legally. I have a son-in-law who is French Congolese. He's kind of gone about this the hard way. You know, he came, it's been about 3.5 years, and he just got his green card recently. So he could be able to work. And our daughter, during that time, had applied for some government services and was not eligible because she was married to a foreigner. And jokingly, I told him, I said, hey, you know, should have come in through Mexico. Then we have all this stuff free.
Well, I mean, if you had come in through Mexico, I mean, if you are unlawfully present in the country, you don't qualify for those sort of public benefits that most lawful immigrants actually don't qualify for either for the first several years that they come into the country.
You may not qualify, but you get them.
No, you don't get them. I mean,
my daughter-in-law is a pediatric ER doctor at Los Angeles General Hospital. She would beg to differ with you.
So in emergency Medicaid will cover treatment in an emergency. But you don't get normal Medicaid, you don't get food stamps, you don't get federal subsidized housing, you don't get a welfare check. So now, and again, if you're a lawful immigrant, you don't get those things either for at least the first 5 years that you're in the country. But I do want to go back to this question of history because I think it's really important.
Sure.
Before 1882, we basically didn't have a federal immigration law, which is to say that there was no illegal immigration because there was no restrictions on who could migrate lawfully to the United States. That's not to say everyone got treated well or that it was an easy process. It was usually a very difficult process on a boat, but we didn't.
Matt, in those periods, did you just come into America, just get off the boat and walk through, or did you go through Ellis Island?
Well, Ellis Island didn't exist till around that time, until around 1890. So prior to that time, you came in at any number of different entry points, again, usually on a boat to that point. But there wasn't such a thing as illegal immigration. So that started with the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, which was our first significant federal restriction on immigration. And then gradually over what we think of as that Ellis Island period, which for a lot of us has sort of romantic sort of memories of those brave immigrants who came in and were, you know, pulled themselves up by their bootstraps and learned English the day they got off the boat. Well, the people at the time who were already Americans, usually one or two generations from their own immigrant experience, did not like most of those Ellis Island immigrants. They were mostly uneducated, not primarily Protestant Christians, but Catholic or Jews coming from Southern or Eastern Europe. And so there was a lot of political pushback to those Ellis Island immigrants. And the result was a series of restrictions on who could migrate lawfully to the country that started in the 1880s and really culminated with a dramatic change to U.S. immigration law in the 1920s that for the first time said, if you want to come and immigrate to this country, you need a visa. You need permission from the U.S. government before you get on the boat or eventually on an airplane or as the case may be.
Yeah.
So that was where we really dramatically shifted our immigration policy. So a lot of Americans say, well, those immigrants should just come legally the way that my ancestors did. My ancestors came here in the 1850s from Holland. But they did come legally. They couldn't have come unlawfully if they wanted to in the 1850s. And I am not suggesting we go back to that open border system. That's not our view at World Relief. But I do think it's important to understand that before we sort of brag about how virtuous our ancestors were compared to the immigrants who come today. The reality is today, if you want to come lawfully to the United States as an immigrant, there are basically four ways to come. You can have a family sponsorship. So for example, your daughter, presumably is a U.S. citizen, files a petition for her spouse. It's not an easy process, but it's possible. It usually takes 6 months to a year, a few thousand dollars in attorney's fees and immigration fees.
Well, our son, who was married to the Dutch Afrikaan, was the same thing.
Yeah, so you got a U.S. citizen with a spouse. That's sort of the best case scenario, and it's the same for minor children or for parents.
But when you do that for a period of 7 years, if anything happens during that 7 years, then you're deported. You have to go back.
If you commit a crime.
Because they want
to
make sure that you haven't just married so you can get to the United States.
Sure, they're looking for, there are all sorts of tests they do to make sure it's a genuine marriage. And they test other family relationships as well. So they may do DNA testing to verify this is actually a child-parent relationship. It is important to know for family reunification, it's only close relatives. So for a U.S. citizen, it's their spouse, children, parent, or sibling. And some of those cases, like a minor child or a spouse, can take 6 months to a year, maybe a little bit longer. A sibling can, or an adult child, can take 20 years, literally, under the current system, because they're very backlogged in those categories.
Now, is that part of what you call chain migration?
That's what some people would call chain migration. Yeah. But I do think there's a misnomer, because people have this idea that you can bring in an unlimited number of immigrants. Well, most people don't have an unlimited number of siblings, parents, children, and spouses, right? I mean, it's immediate family members only. So, but then again, there's a lot of immigrants who don't have that relative to begin with. So the next possibility would be an employer-sponsored immigrant. That means you've got a company in the United States, files a petition for a foreign-born worker to come immigrate to the U.S.
Which is what's happening in Silicon Valley a lot.
Exactly. And the vast majority of those visas under the Immigration Nationality Act, there's 140,000 of those visas available each year. The vast majority of them, all but 5,000, are specifically designated for those who are considered highly skilled. So those Silicon Valley workers coming to fill jobs in the tech industry, or maybe the medical field, or you know, there's a few other industries where you usually have to have a master's degree is basically the standard there. But there's a lot of jobs that don't require a master's degree in our economy, in agriculture, in the hospitality industry, in construction, in manufacturing. But there are labor needs, especially at a time when our unemployment rate is under 4%. And so that's, I think, one of the key challenges, is we have a lot more job needs than we have employer-sponsored immigrant visas for those who are not classified as highly skilled. The third category for lawful migration is the refugee status. So that's someone who meets this formal definition of someone who has fled a well-founded fear of persecution on account of their race, religion, political opinion, national origin, or social group. So there's about 25 million refugees in the world today. This year, only about less than 23,000 will be invited to the United States as refugees through the U.S. Refugee Resettlement Program. So it's only less than 0.1% who make the cut. It's very selective, but it is a possibility for a few. And by the way, that number is way down. In 1980, we admitted more than 220,000 refugees through that program. And then there's others who come also meeting the definition of a refugee, but they show up whether on an airplane with a temporary visa or at the US-Mexico border or the US-Canadian border, and they say, I meet the definition of a refugee. If you send me back, I face this well-founded fear of persecution for one of these reasons, and the US will then adjudicate their cases. The last possibility is something called the Diversity Visa Lottery, which is an online lottery. The odds of winning last year were something like 1 in 300. And you can only enter the lottery if you are from what's considered an underrepresented country. So if you're from Mexico or South Korea, China, India, Canada, the United Kingdom, you cannot apply for that lottery. And I think it's important to go through those four processes because there's a whole bunch of people who would like to come lawfully to the United States, who would be willing to go through a process, who would be willing to pay a fee, and they don't fit into any one of those four buckets. But if they manage to get here other than lawfully, either entering across the border unlawfully or overstaying a temporary visa, they will very quickly find a job at a time when our unemployment rate is so low. And I think that's how we've in some ways created this real problem where one part of our government is saying, you're not supposed to be here, sort of the stop sign at the border. Another part of our government is saying, help wanted. In fact, we have made it possible to file and pay your taxes if you are here working unlawfully. There's a lot of mixed messages coming from our federal government. And what we've said at World Relief is, we're not saying illegal immigration is a good thing. We're saying we should facilitate legal immigration, not without limit, but to meet the needs of our economy, and make it harder to immigrate illegally. And then make a process for those who are already here, who've been in this limbo situation, to admit that they've broken the law, to pay a fine, to make things right, and to eventually earn legal status and citizenship over the course of a number of years.
The bottom line of all of it is that the government needs to get its act together. And really start passing some legitimate, reasonable, balanced immigration laws and try to resolve some of the chaos that's going on and the polarization that's going on.
That has been our message, and you know, we've been saying that when President Bush was pushing for this, when President Obama was pushing for it. This has actually been a bipartisan issue, but it's never had quite the votes to make it over the finish line in Congress, and that's really, you know, we've done with a lot of other Christian groups, the National Association of Evangelicals, the Southern Baptist Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission, the National Hispanic Christian Leadership Conference. All these Christian groups have come forward and said, we need immigration reform on a bipartisan basis that is, yes, honoring the law, yes, respecting taxpayers, yes, securing our borders, but also keeping families together, respecting the dignity of each person, and providing a pathway forward for those who are here unlawfully to not get a free pass, but to be able to earn permanent legal status if they're willing to work for it.
Coming up, Matt talks about how the church should respond to immigrants and says that while there can be many Christian perspectives on immigration, there is one specifically non-Christian position. He'll tell us what that is right after the break.
Rick Warren said it's not, you know, the Good Samaritan doesn't stop and ask the person injured on the side of the road, are you legal or illegal? And I think we should be very cautious with any attempt from the federal or any state government to make any restrictions on how the church can minister to people.
Welcome back. Today we're talking about the controversial issue of immigration with Matt Soerens. Matt works with immigrants and refugees through World Relief. He has co-authored the book, Welcoming the Stranger, which gives a thorough history of U.S. immigration policy and explains the complexities surrounding the issue today. As believers, Scripture both instructs us to show hospitality to the foreigners among us and to obey the laws of the land. And that's why believers can and do have very different opinions on the topic. But Matt also says there is one take on the issue that Christians should never have. You talk about the fact that there in your book about that there is not one Christian perspective, but there is one non-Christian perspective. Talk about that.
Yeah, well, I think that Christians can have a lot of different views on how we respond to public policies, but I don't think a Christian can read the Bible and come to a perspective that views immigrants, regardless of any factor, as other than human, as other than people made in the image of God, whom that doesn't mean we have to condone every activity, but we have to respect their personhood, respect that they are a person made in the image of God with inherent dignity, whose life is worth valuing and protecting, and who also has inherent potential because they're made in the image of the Creator God. Yeah. And I think sometimes when we talk about immigration, we talk about big numbers, and we forget that at the core of this is a person. Again, that doesn't mean we all have to agree on what the right immigration policy is. I think it does inform how we need to, as Christians, interact with our immigrant neighbors, whether they are here unlawfully or they are refugees who are invited by the U.S. State Department, or they come in through a family reunification visa or an employer visa, or however they got here. We have to keep in mind that they are people made in God's image, just like every other one of our neighbors.
So, you know, in your book, you talk about the stranger among us, which has to do with Leviticus 13.
Chapter 19, 33, yeah.
You know, I read that as God saying, the people who are here among us, you need to respect, you need to give them respect, you need to treat them as citizens. But it doesn't necessarily talk about how they got there.
No.
And there were some pretty stringent rules about strangers among the land also. But sometimes when I hear that used, it's used in the context of open borders, that whoever comes, regardless of how they get here, whether legal, it doesn't matter how they got here. When they get here, we're responsible, and that Leviticus verse is used.
I think there's both the question of how do we respond as individual believers to the people who we may encounter as our neighbors, and then there's the other question of how does our government respond? And so there's a role for the church and there's a role for the state.
Which you just raised an incredibly important issue too. And even when Christ was here and you know he gave us a lot of instructions of things to do, he was talking about, I've heard people say, well, Jesus was socialist. Jesus never talked about government. He talked about an individual responsibility, not government responsibility. He said, if somebody wants your coat, give them your cloak also. If they want to walk a mile, walk 2 miles. He didn't suggest that the Roman government do that. It was an individual response for Christ-likeness.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the words of Jesus that come to my mind when he talks about government is give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's.
Yep.
So I think that is to say the government does have its role in any number of matters, but that would certainly include setting an immigration policy. And to be really clear, we've never taken the position that Leviticus chapter 19 means open borders.
Yep.
You know, I think you have a number of passages that define a role for the government. And it's appropriate for our government to maintain restrictions on who is allowed to come to the United States. That doesn't mean that as citizens in a democracy, we also can't speak into that and say, actually, we think these numbers are too low. They're actually not maximizing even just the economic interest of the country. Or we think that the value of having unified families is such that we should make it easier for families to be reunited more quickly through a legal process. But again, we're not in any way advocating for illegal immigration. I do think we can take another question of, well, how should the church respond to those who are in our communities, who are undocumented, who are not lawfully present?
And it's a good question.
And I think,
how do you respond to that?
I mean, I think that's where I would say my role as an individual, as a local person in the local church, is to show the love of God, to share the gospel, to meet people's physical needs. And by the way, none of that is illegal. Nothing in U.S. law says that it's against the law for the church to show kindness to people, to run a food pantry, to teach English classes. We should be cautious of any federal restriction on church ministry. That becomes a religious liberty issue, I think. Rick Warren said it's not, you know, the Good Samaritan doesn't stop and ask the person injured on the side of the road, are you legal or illegal? And I think we should be very cautious with any attempt from the federal or any state government to make any restrictions on how the church can minister to people.
After the break, final thoughts on politics and immigration.
There was Democrats in the Senate who voted voted for amendments that they knew would essentially kill that legislation. Now, we've seen politics on the Republican side of this as well, and so I think I'm not here to blame one party or the other. I think there's bipartisan blame to go around.
I appreciate all of the work that Matt Soerens and World Relief are doing on behalf of immigrants and refugees. You can get a copy of Matt's book, Welcoming the Stranger, online wherever books are sold. Probably the hardest work in this area is in Washington advocating for the right kinds of immigration reform. In today's final thoughts, Matt and I discuss the politics of immigration and what kind of reform he hopes to see someday. Well, let me toss a incendiary statement into the mix right now. A lot of people believe that the Democrats are using, especially socialist Democrats, are using the immigration issue as a way to build, with open borders and all, to build a dependent society. How do you respond to that?
You know, I think there's been a lot of politics on both sides of the aisle on this issue. And I mean, I've been working on this for more than 10 years. There were Democrats who voted back when President Bush was supporting immigration reform, who voted for amendments that they knew would kill that sort of a bipartisan immigration reform bill.
Because they were talking a lot more about more strict immigration policy.
Well, and I mean, the sort of proposal that was promoted by Senator McCain and Senator Kennedy back in 2006 and 2007, so a bipartisan duo, both passed on now, and was supported by President Bush, I think if that bill would have passed, we wouldn't be in the situation we're in today. We'd be so much better off. And frankly, for the Republican Party, it would have been a huge opportunity for President Bush to be able to sign that legislation, which he wanted to sign. There was Democrats in the Senate who voted for amendments that they knew would essentially kill that legislation. Now, we've seen politics on the Republican side of this as well. And so I think I'm not here to blame one party or the other. I think there's bipartisan blame to go around.
But you're caught in the middle of it.
Well, it's people who are caught in the middle of it much more directly than I am, families who are caught in the middle of it, who just want to make things right, and that process doesn't exist. So we've been telling Republicans and Democrats and independents that these are principles that we think are consistent with biblical values. We've been part of this group at the Evangelical Immigration Table making that case, saying these principles ought to be guiding members of Congress and all parties and the president, whoever that is, President Trump or President Obama or President Bush. We've been at this for a while. If it's not done yet, we'll tell it to the next president as well. But these are principles that we think should be guiding our country. Not to say amnesty and open borders, we think that's not an option, nor to say deport everyone and seal off the country, no more immigrants. We think we should be a nation of immigrants and a nation of laws, a nation of compassion, but that also honors the law and respects our security and our sovereignty.
I think most conservatives, at least, would agree with you 100%.
You know, we did a poll a few years ago. We found that more than two-thirds of evangelical Christians said they would support the sort of proposal that we've asked for, that would combine improved border security with an earned pathway to citizenship for immigrants who are here unlawfully, who make certain restitution and are able to work towards that status.
I really appreciate Matt being on the program with me today, and this is such an important issue that we're going to continue it for another week, because we do have, in fact, a major crisis, and the problem is that we've not been dealing with it, and it's time to do something about it. And I believe strongly that as Christians, that we have to have compassion, we have to reach out in compassion, we have to be concerned about those who are in need, the refugees and so forth. At the same time, there's such a thing as rule of law, and how we deal with those two aspects, the compassion that is needed. I mean, we have been, in fact, for all these years, a nation of immigrants. In fact, I think of my ancestors who came from Scotland, and you probably are thinking of your ancestors who came from somewhere. And in that sense, we're all immigrants. But at the same time, there needs to be a system. There needs to be enormous amounts of reform that is taking place in our Congress. And I think we need to make sure that we hold our Congress accountable and let them know that we do want reform. We do want a compassionate response. But at the same time, we have to stop illegal immigration, and we do, in fact, have to protect our borders. I think it's a matter that every Christian should be concerned about, and that's why we have had Matt on, and that's why we want to even extend it for another week, because it is such an important issue. And it's something that I would ask you to make a matter of prayer, that God would help our leaders to have the wisdom in how to deal with a very complex and a very controversial issue that has two polar extreme sides that are battling each other. But we need to come together in a compassionate response, but make sure that we protect our borders and deal with the question of illegal immigration. Thanks for joining us. It's always a pleasure to have you with us on Significant Insights, and I look forward to you being with us again next week. Thank you. God bless you. We'll see you then.